The Ask Dr. Tommy O Show is sponsored by Health Education Learning Program, Inc., a nonprofit organization aimed at helping underserved residents of New York City to live a healthier life through health education and community outreach programs. This series, Corporal Punishment, is supported by Bishop Dr. Timothy Paquette, Senior Pastor of Church Life Community Church, and Kathy G. Hsu, CPA, CEO of Diamond Accounting. Special thanks to Dr. Patrick Petroche, psychiatrist, for sponsoring our shows. Corporal Punishment Part 2. The discipline or not the discipline is the question.
Welcome to the Ask Dr. Tommy O Show. The Ask Dr. Tommy O Show takes a holistic approach to our community's healthcare needs and concerns. And I am your host, Dr. Tommy O. Well, today's topic, Corporal Punishment Part 2. The discipline or not the discipline is the question. From a psychiatric perspective. So let's get right into the show because we have only 28 minutes. We got a lot of information to cover. So I'd like to introduce a good friend of mine, someone I've known almost 25 years, one of my study partners from medical school. And he's big out in the Midwest. So I invited him back. So I'd like to welcome Dr. Patrick Petroche. Doc.
How you doing, Tom? Hey. It's great to be back in the city. How you doing? Everything right. Going well?
Yeah.
Good.
How you feeling today?
I'm feeling good. Just flew in.
Yes.
My arms are killing me. There you go. It's an old one. So anyway, what do you want to know about corporal punishment? What is it that you think your listeners would want to know?
Right. Well, you know, we hear just the mainstream media, and they don't cover it like we do. It's a very generalized topic. So we took it, part one, from a spiritual perspective, from Bishop Paquette, but I want it from your perspective, like we did when we covered cyberbullying. No one covered the topic like we did. We took it from a different approach, different aspect, because we're not one-dimensional, we are three-dimensional, where it's the mind, body, and spirit, mind, body, and soul. So we're going to go over the mind aspect.
Mind part of it. Yes. Did you already cover the body?
Yeah, we covered the body.
All right. Now, I know you've already defined it, but from a psychiatric viewpoint, discipline, which is what we're talking about, is really trying to form a rule set for your culture. That's really what discipline is about, trying to get your kids to conform to your cultural norms. And discipline can take several different forms. And corporal punishment comes from the word corpus, which means your body. So you physically punish a child in order to be able to get them to fit the cultural norms.
Right.
That's really what everybody does. And everybody's culture is different. Your culture out here in New York is much different than my culture back home in Iowa, the greatest state in the union, by the way. And back home, when we first heard about Adrian Peterson, keep in mind, we're next door. You know, everybody in Iowa is a giant Vikings fan or Bears. So when we heard about Adrian Peterson, there were a lot of people who initially, before the pictures came out, said, well, hold on. It's not like we run around and beat our kids, but, you know, if your child is really behaving badly and may be a danger to yourself, yeah, you swat them. Here's what the problem with Adrian Peterson came down to. When you look at those pictures, there are multiple strike marks from a weapon. And that, from a psychiatric viewpoint, is how we define abuse. Number one, it leaves a permanent mark, and that is a mark that lasts more than 24 hours. Mm-hmm. If you grab your kid by the arm, right, and pull him up, and you leave a small bruise, that is not abuse. That's, you know, like if you're pulling him back from running into the street, something like that. But when you take a weapon, and that could be any weapon, it could be a wooden spoon, it could be a fly swatter, in this case, it was a willow switch, mm-hmm. and strike multiple times, leaving a mark and permanent damage, because there were open wounds on this poor kid from pictures I saw. Those are going to leave scars. That's a permanent thing.
Right.
And that's when it falls into abuse. Now, culturally, this is where psychiatry is on a slippery slope. How do you define that? When I grew up, everybody in my town got the switch. My mom happened to use a fly swatter. Now, keep in mind, you know me, that most of the time when my mom had to get the fly swatter out, I probably needed it.
Right.
But the problem is, norms are different today. Mm-hmm. They're not like they were when we grew up. The story about, and this is not corroborated. I don't know if this is a story with Adrian Peterson, but he made his son go out, cut the switch, and bring it back in. That was a story. I can't tell you, growing up, how many of my friends had exactly the same story. These are good parents, successful parents. My friends are now successful. They're not suffering adverse consequences to this. But what used to be viewed as being a good parent, at this point, 40 years ago, is no longer what we consider a good parent today.
Right.
And so when you're changing norms, and particularly in America, because norms switch so quickly with the way our society is, mm-hmm. It's very difficult for parents really to understand what's acceptable and what is not.
Right. I think we saw the change start to occur in the 90s when they had that timeout. Go in a corner, face the corner, timeout. We didn't have that growing up.
No, because if your parents had to put you in the corner, they put you in that corner. I mean, they drew it way back and whap,
right.
And that's how it was for us.
Right.
Now, one of the things that's occurring now is we have an entire generation, for multiple reasons, that are completely out of control. They won't work. They don't want to get a job. Mm-hmm. They want to do something meaningful. They want to start at the top of the food chain. A lot of kids I deal with, they think that if they get a job at McDonald's, they ought to own that McDonald's before they work there. You've encountered this,
mm-hmm.
And I work with children all day long. It's a pervasive attitude. Now, there's a lot of reasons for this, but specifically the role that corporal punishment plays in this is this. People, and particularly parents, are afraid of the government. They don't want their children taken. They don't want any problems at school. They don't want to have to deal with the hassle. Because the threat of having your child taken away from you permanently is a real threat. And the problem comes from, now you're not disciplining at all. Now there's no discipline in the home.
Right.
Because you have children calling 911 and DHS when their parents are putting them in the corner because that's too extreme for them. That's the next change that's coming on, is no punishment. I mean, in the psych review journals that I read, there are actually people out there that write, should we discipline at all? I mean, and they make an argument for it. I don't believe it's a good argument.
Right.
So when you start talking about corporal punishment as part of discipline, keep in mind that means that you have to go out of your way to injure your child. Getting a switch and beating your child with that switch is beyond what you should do. We have several studies out there about the effects of discipline and the effects of abuse. And what we know is if a child suffers from abuse, and as a physician you recognize it, for your listeners, I'll define it. It really comes down to perception, not necessarily from the child, but from the interviewer. It's very subjective, and it's a requirement that I disagree with. However, that's one way they define it. The second one is no marks lasting the 24 hours. The third one is was there a weapon of some kind used? A weapon doesn't mean a knife, a gun. It means using a switch. It means grabbing something by your hand and hitting somebody else with it. Those are the main criteria. Now, one of the strange things that we have in schools is we have parents that won't discipline and teachers that are allowed to corporally punish children. And that differs from school region mm-hmm. to school region.
Right.
In Iowa, we have fairly tight rules. You know, generally, teachers don't touch the children in Iowa. But there are other states that do have those rules.
Right. They said, statistically, they said the southern states.
Yes. And that's what I was going to bring up. Georgia. I was just sitting in Atlanta And so I thought I'd look up their rules. But yeah, and you're allowed to use it. So if you look at the number of cases that are reported for corporal punishment in the schools, it really is a little bit higher than you would expect from the rest of the country. Now keep in mind, Adrian Peterson's from the South.
Right.
And the bottom line is there's been several comments made, well, if you took any Southern black family, they're all guilty of doing the same thing. That's what I've read in the paper. So, you know, part of it is you need to start educating on how to more effectively parent your child. And corporal punishment can help in certain cases. Let's keep in mind, most of the time, kids will learn if you teach them. They will learn if you give them an example to follow. And they will also learn if you make sure your boundaries are firm. Not saying, oh, you can't go out and do this one day, and the next day you say, well, yeah, go ahead and do that very same thing I told you not to the day before.
Okay, I think if you practice what you preach.
Absolutely.
And going back to the boundaries, where you have your parents telling you one thing and they're doing the exact opposite, that's a poor role model.
Yes, absolutely. So when you start talking to these parents about what they need to do, you need to make sure that they are very, very consistent. If you have a family that smokes marijuana, right, you're going to get a child that smokes marijuana. Mm-hmm. If you have a family with doctors and people that are educated, you're going to get children that want to be educated.
Right.
You know, your family's an example of that. My family's an example of that. The problem comes from, and this is where I see a lot of kids, there are certain kids who we'll just put those in quotation marks, modern ways of disciplining your child really aren't going to be effective. These are children who, for whatever reason, are hardwired to derive enjoyment from bullying, irritating other people. And some of these kids really look at you like, well, what are you going to do, right? Now, having partaken in raising several children, I will tell you some of them are just looking just to get a rise out of you.
Mm-hmm.
That's what they like doing. Oftentimes, they just want to fight. That's their nature, right? Lawyers are a lot like that, right? They do things just because they want to fight.
Mm-hmm.
And when you have a child like that, telling them to go stand in the corner is not going to do you any good. And that's when, at the end of it, maybe corporal punishment could come into it.
Right.
I remember my mom really, really tried to avoid using any kind of physical coercion. She really did avoid that. There were times when she had to use corporal redirection with me. And there's one time when she had to do that with my son. Well, in the situation with my son, he ran out into the street after my mom told him not to. Now, we lived out in the country. The problem is we had a cement company about a half mile down the road. These trucks would go by 60, 70 miles an hour. So you couldn't be in the street. So mom went out there, and he kept running out into the street thinking it was a game. It wasn't a game. And finally, my mom corrected him. Now, she didn't beat him. She didn't get a switch, even though we had a willow tree in the front yard. All right? But the bottom line is she had to do that. And that was the only time she ever had to do it. The rest of the time, you know, Pat would pretty much do what my mom said. So you have all kinds of angles with this. And a lot of times, if you're consistent with your discipline, you don't have to go to the corporal punishment route. But there are times when, for the sake of enforcing a rule that is critical, such as not playing in the street. I mean, not playing in the street back home is not nearly as important as not playing in the street out here, right? and especially when you're getting off work, because I've seen you drive.
Right? Exactly. That way.
So the bottom line is when you're trying to figure out what the next step is to get your child to do what they're supposed to do when they're supposed to do it. Keep in mind, there's a lot of different things you can do, but if you decide to use corporal punishment, remember the rules. If you're gonna use corporal punishment, it has to be your hand. You can't have something in your hand.
Mm-hmm.
You can't have multiple strikes, whatever you leave behind can't last more than 24 hours. And if you do, by definition, it's abuse. And that's simply where we come from. I've dealt with families whose method of discipline was to boil water and stick their hands in. For generations, that's what they've done. Well, that's not the way you do it anymore. It shouldn't even be the way you did it back then.
Right.
But that, you know, there's a lot of cultural norms, and there are cultures within cultures within cultures.
Right. Let me just add to that. Hold on. Yeah. During my residency, I was a senior resident, and in the Bronx, in what we say the west section of the Bronx, we had a very large influx of Africans that came over, and we had a lot of children that came in with their bottoms with second-degree burns. And we, at first you're thinking, there's a burn. But we saw that there was a pattern, and so we had to report this. And it was part of discipline. Maybe the kid was crying, whatever. We're talking infants, and they were just the bottom. And we never seen this before, and it must have been within their culture to punish that way, for stopping from crying because they're hungry or whatever it happened to be. So going back to, like you said, the customs and norms of that particular community, but here.
Oh, yeah. Well, as you know, Iowa, and particularly in Des Moines, is what they call an immigration depot, mm-hmm. where, you know, if these people don't have a place to go, this is where they come.
Yeah, the hub.
And you remember Homes of Oak Ridge,
mm-hmm.
all right? What has happened there is all the immigrants moved there. And what you have is the entire community raising every child there, whether they're Mexican, Malaysian, Dinkins. We have a large Dinkin population now. And they've all kind of melded into this, some don't do anything, and then when they do, it's way over the top. And, as you know, Dinkins are the ones with the ritual scarification.
Mm-hmm.
You know, over there, when you're 13, that's when that begins.
Right.
And so we've had several cases about, well, is that child abuse? Is that discipline? Or is that a cultural thing? Right. And so, you know, that's one of the things that America struggles with routinely.
Mm-hmm.
You know, your family being an immigration family, you've told me stories about how there was some difficulty with your family integrating,
mm-hmm.
Way back when.
Absolutely.
So we're facing the same thing. But what's happening is, at least in Iowa, is all these families are creating their own melting pot. They're being raised as a village. They're all in it together. They all share all kinds of duties. They cook for each other. And when somebody else's child acts up, you're the one that disciplines them.
Mm-hmm.
And so we get a lot of problems back and forth with who has the right to discipline at that point.
Right.
So
good point right there, because I was going to bring this up, and that's a great segue. And this wasn't planned. Now, you know, Kathy and I, we got married. Kathy was my high school sweetheart, and we had a 20-year gap, and we've been together a little bit more than 9 years. Just in March, you celebrated with me our wedding. And but I'm helping her raise her twin 16-year-old girls, and I felt uncomfortable being a disciplinarian. And Kathy would respond, "Well, you are their dad, so you can." But if it happened directly in front of me, I would discipline them. But it was a hands off. One, they're girls. Two, they're not my biological children, so I have to be very careful, because whenever something goes wrong, it's always the stepdad or the uncle. Statistically, we know.
Yes.
So I make sure I keep a distance. But I felt it wasn't my place to do the physical or the corporal or the discipline. More of a light verbal discipline, especially if it happens in front of me. More like, come on, girls, you know better. You know, I think one time I really had to get down and literally slam my hand on the table and kind of like, go to your room, you know, because they were really, really acting up. And I felt bad after that. And I went back and I apologized and explained what they did wrong and why I had to do this. But I just felt it's Kathy's place, because of being a biological mom versus,
yes.
You know, the stepdad. That's just how I feel.
Well, let me speak to that. You said three very interesting things. One, you felt uncomfortable being the disciplinarian because you weren't the biological dad.
Right.
And when I deal with mixed families, the first thing I tell the non-biological parent, listen, stay out of the way, You're not there to discipline. You make the child, you make the biological parent discipline, mm-hmm. because these kids won't respond to you. Now, in your case, I mean, if we're talking personally, the girls do look at you as their father.
Right. They do. Since 7.
And that would be an exception to that rule. Mm-hmm. You know, the second thing you said that was interesting to me is you said, well, you know, I didn't feel like I should discipline, you know, them being girls and all. Mm-hmm. Well, it would have been different for you if had they been boys.
I would be, yes, because as being coming from like my father and how I was raised, guys can handle it. The boys can handle a little bit more. Not necessarily I have to be physical with them, but I can get in their face and mix it up a little bit. With the girls, they don't have the same approach. It was more of a soft hands off. But if it was boys, definitely I'd be in their face. I would definitely my approach would be a little bit different. Still not the corporal punishment, but I would definitely would challenge them more to listen. But I felt, yeah. you know, me comfortably standing back.
And you're not the only parent I've ever dealt with that has had this kind of dichotomy. Mm. The boys will be physically punished, and the girls will have a verbal reprisal.
Well, they say statistically that's the case to begin with. But
and you pointed out exactly why. Oh, well, I don't think girls can take that kind of abuse, right? Or I don't think girls could handle it. We're different. And the truth of the matter is, you should be as consistent as you can, whether you have a boy or a girl. You know, it should be the same punishment no matter what happens. If you don't believe that your children should be having premarital sex, don't make it okay for the boy and not okay for the girl. You have to apply it equally. Now, Tom and I are from a different generation, but the bottom line is, you know, I was from a military family. Everybody in family got punished equally. Mm-hmm. It didn't matter what happened.
Right.
So my advice as far as raising a mixed household of sexes, you have to be consistent. If you're going to hit a boy for something, then it's the same punishment for the girl.
Right.
And you know, and you're right. They think differently. They feel differently. They do things differently. But simply because they're a female instead of a male doesn't mean you should parent differently for that child.
Right. You're going back to mixing. I was lucky because the twins, they're both girls. Yeah. So equally, my approach was equal to both. So I answered good, your question good. There.
you got out of that one, didn't you? That's right, baby. So, you know, Kathy is a disciplinarian, but you kind of skipped over your cultural differences. Mm-hmm. I mean, you're Catholic, right. You know, you're a mix of Irish and Italian, yeah. You know, two very strong Catholic faiths. And I know that when we went to school together, because I'm Catholic too, you know, that was something that we had in common. It was important right. for both of us. I had my crucifix, you had yours.
Right.
Hanging from the... So here you are marrying into a Jewish family.
Right.
And she's marrying into a Catholic family. And, you know, you're always going to have conflicts there about how you discipline. You and I both know how Catholics discipline. We just talked about it. But, you know, the Jews have a tendency to use a lot of guilt. They have a tendency to use a lot not necessarily Old Testament, but they sit there and they talk about, here are the rules, here are the laws, this is what you're doing.
Right.
And, you know, you go from there. Not that Catholic moms aren't great at guilt, I'm not saying that.
But
you know, it's always different, yeah. You know. Right. And when you're dealing with difficult children, a lot of times your last recourse is, you know, physical punishment, particularly if they're doing something on purpose over and over just to create chaos. That would be one reason.
Right.
Safety issues. My saying in my household is, it is a matter of safety and not subject to debate.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and if it was a safety issue, that was the end of it. And if you violated it, you know, punishment was going to increase. And the third reason why corporal punishment may be acceptable is, if there's going to be danger to somebody else. A lot of times you'll get children that hurt the younger children over and over. Now, there's a lot of conflict. Mostly psychiatrists say, well, if you use corporal punishment, then what you get is violent children. Well, the truth of the matter is usually the parents have tried just about everything they can with a violent child, and then finally they become violent themselves.
Right.
And that's the usual thing. Now, I'm not talking about guys going out there or girls going out there and beating the heck out of the kids. That isn't what I'm talking about. But there are kids out there that need a different form of discipline.
Right.
than what's typically available or right, prescribed.
Atypical presentation.
You bet.
All right. Well, we have only about 2 minutes left, okay?
All right.
So what I'd like you to do is, let's talk about you. We're 25, it's almost 25 years knowing each other. You're a psychiatrist. You have a huge, one of the largest practices in the Midwest. Go over that, and then you also have a radio show, and finish the show.
Well, you know what's funny? When I met Tom, you know, you got to keep in mind, Tom and I clown around a lot. But when it comes time to be serious, we're right on the mark. And what's funny is you've risen to the top of your profession, and I've risen to the top of my profession.
We
were the class clowns. So don't ever let anybody tell you that you have to be serious all the time. You just need to be serious when the time is right.
That's correct.
The second thing is you told me you had a show, right, and that inspired me to go get my own.
There you go.
Honest. So my show is called Doc and Lefty, and we have a website, docandlefty.com. That's docandlefty.com. And we discuss, I have a friend of mine who's very liberal, we discuss the issues of the day. In fact, on Tuesday we went over Ebola, and we had a very knowledgeable guest on that had been in the Naval Medical Corps for a long time, and we discussed that. We discuss a lot of the political issues. It's usually a fusion of political issues, medical issues, state, local, national, international politics. We get a lot of great guests on the show. Since I was first in the nation for the presidents, we get a lot of high-end people on the show.
Right.
And it's not a presidential year, so, you know, they're kind of staying away. But we get a lot of people. We had one of the candidates for governor on a couple of weeks ago. Next week is another candidate for governor. We have state senators, congressmen, all that kind of stuff that we interview and talk to in the party machine. So don't forget to tune in on docandlefty.com every Tuesday evening from 6:30 to 7:30 p.m. We also have a YouTube channel. We have a podcast. We have Facebook. We have Twitter. And it got so much, I hired a gal to do all the social media. So I have no idea what else we're on, but we're on all that. With additional good news, we've gotten some pretty good backing. It looks like we may have a shot at going nationwide.
Yeah.
So
syndicated?
Yeah.
Excellent.
That'd be great.
That's beautiful. So it's pretty funny looking back. Our classmates looking at us now, yeah, like it's not the same.
No, it isn't. You know, because I always tell our story to these poor kids going like, I don't know, you know. I'm like, listen, you don't have to be exactly how everybody else is.
Right. Just enjoy yourself.
Yeah. And I tell them about you, and I tell them about me, and I said 90% of the time, you know, we're clowning around. When we were at school, that's what we did.
That's it.
That was it. So.
All right. Well, we got to wrap this up because we might even be overtime. Patrick Petros, he is a huge psychiatrist. Not huge, huge psychiatrist.
He's always making fun of my girth.
All right. I want to thank you for being on the show.
All right.
It's a pleasure. Thanks, always come on out here and making a difference in the community. And good luck with your new show going global now. And that's what we want to see, because then we could turn around and laugh at our school.
Yeah. And then you can say, hey, I know that guy.
That's right. I want to thank everyone, our viewers. I hope you enjoyed this. Yeah. We enjoyed it. I always enjoy it. We have fun. Like I said, we have 20. It's going to be 25 years and making a difference in the community.
Yep.
So I want to thank you. And
well, thanks for having me on. I really do like coming out here and being on your show.
All right.
All right.
Okay. Well, stay alive with Church Alive, and God bless America.